فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحوم كالطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
Assalamu alaikum, and it's a great pleasure to have you in the Gambia in our midst. I know this has been years in the preparation, mashallah. We're very glad you made it in time. I hope you like the smiling coast.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Indeed, I'm a person who usually likes to smile. So coming to a place named after what I like to do, the smiling coast, obviously we gelled almost immediately. Alhamdulillah, yes, it has been a long, long time. I have been planning this for a long time, but for some reason, always there was a delay. There was a cancellation at one stage. And here we are, you know, at the timing of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm so happy that it happened now. I don't think there could have been a better time.
MashaAllah. Now, getting right into it, building bridges. How did you come with such an apt name in the world that we are now, and with all the conflict, mayhem, chaos, and the need to build those bridges, to my mind, is to bring about synergy, about peaceful coexistence and oneness, unity, if you will.
Precisely. Actually, I started maybe 2.5 to 3 years back. The first Building Bridges tour happened in Sri Lanka. And we discussed various topics, and exactly as you say, witnessing what's going on across the globe with Islam being a very peaceful religion, with Islam being there for centuries, and yet you have people who, you know, on two fronts. One, those who have abused or misused the religion in order to forward their own agenda, and those who have misunderstood that the whole of Islam and the Muslims are bad. So we have those two. We are somewhere trying to explain to those who are abusing the religion not to do that, and those who are Islamophobes to educate them to be able to remedy their own phobia. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. That is the way that we actually came about with this Building Bridges tour. And I've been to so many countries. If you were to ask me to name them, I wouldn't be able to do them. To do that, because it's been going on for so many years, and we are speaking about coming together. Obviously, as Muslims, the first bridge that we should be concerned about is the bridge with your maker. Some of us are distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it goes way beyond. I think the core of this entire theme is building bridges with the non-Muslims, with those whom we disagree with those whose faith is different from ours, those who incline differently, those who think differently. And it's a learning curve, because there are so many challenges we face now that a person of my age did not face when we were younger and growing up. As you know, technology has advanced in leaps and bounds. Yes. So we too need to think of how to utilize this technology in a way that educates, that brings people together, that deals with the problems of the heart, that deals with the issues facing human beings, our character and conduct, together with the faith that we belong to. So we have so much in common with humankind, but unfortunately, there are the few pointers that we differ in that make us sometimes not realize how we should be managing these differences. And for that reason, in the Gambia, we will be discussing respecting differences. Because obviously, as you know, it's common logic that we will differ even amongst ourselves, even amongst people of the same grouping, the same families. Mm-hmm. We have differences. Mm-hmm. How to manage those differences? That is a topic that, inshallah, we are discussing at the main event that will be happening at the stadium, inshallah.
We would want to assume our country is a direct opposite of your country. We have a larger Muslim community in the Gambia. Would I be right to say you come from a minority Muslim country?
Absolutely correct. So while our countries are quite similar when it comes to the issues that we're facing, yes, with the economics and, yes, and other problems, you know, we're African, we're third world, etc. Yes. But when it comes to the population of Muslims, we are totally the opposite. Just like you have 95%, perhaps, I'm, yes, not too sure of the exact figure, yes, 95% Muslim, we have 95% non-Muslim. So, alhamdulillah, I think I have grown up in a system that was surrounded by people of other faiths, and yet we were free to practice our faith, and we respected others, they respected us. We did not impose on them that which went against their faith, and in turn, they did not impose on us what went against our faith. And with this respect, we coexisted in the most beautiful way. Businesses were run together, partnerships happened, people of other faiths, schools, we went together to the schools, the hospitals, and everything else happened together. But when it came to faith, people went to their churches, we went to our mosques, some went to the synagogue, some went to the mandirs, some went to the places of worship that they had, and some didn't want to worship at all. And some actually worship totally differently from us. But alhamdulillah, we knew that we discussed matters, we spoke about matters, no one shoved down the other's throat what he or she felt was disrespectful for him or her. So alhamdulillah, yes, we are very different, but we have a lot to take from each other. I believe that, you know, having been in the Gambia for a whole day, I think I've already learned so much. I look out for a lot of these little pointers that we would learn. You know, the love, the hospitality, the goodness, the kindness, the potential for the growth within the nation. That growth, whether it is economic growth or growth in any other sphere of you know, the country, what is important for us to know is it's impossible to achieve proper growth unless we have peaceful coexistence, respecting each other, even the minorities that exist. It's very, very important to respect their rights, the rights of these minorities in their worship and so on, because obviously we as Muslims, it doesn't mean that because we are in the majority, we can just, you know, walk over those who are in the minority. There are other countries like mine where we are in the minority. How would we feel if people just, you know, walked all over us and ignored us and our rights? I think the same would apply in the opposite situation. And this is why we say we respect each other and we must stand up for each other's human rights, at least. May Allah make it easy for us.
Well, I have this urge to ask you this question. I don't know why I didn't begin with it. I've been trailing you for years and I see you all over. And when I say all over, I mean all over. Do you, Sheikh, have time for you?
If you notice, my trip to the Gambia is 2 days, not more. Why? Because I need that time for me, subhanallah. Yes, I'm extremely busy. I do spend the majority of my time at home in Zimbabwe. But my travels are carefully planned throughout the year. And I try and make the most of a journey. Today was my first day in Banjul, in the Gambia. I must have participated in 10 to 12 different events and programs in this one day, this being not the last of today, for example. But inshallah, you know, it's for the sake of Allah, we utilize that energy while we can to do good work. And it's Allah who gives acceptance. I'm sure there are people who do more than what I do, but maybe we don't know about it. Allah knows, and Allah will give it acceptance. So we need to utilize technology to advance a good cause, you know. And I'm sure when you do good, when you are realistic, people will realize that this person's actually saying something that I can relate to. And therefore, it's given more prominence sometimes because the public gives it that prominence.
Modern day Muslims, you talked about social media, you talked about reaching out, you talked about, you talk to a global audience on a daily basis.
That's true, yeah.
The good, the bad, the ugly are all fused together in this melting, useful medium of communication called the social media space. What would be your advice to young Muslims who are in and out of social media on a daily basis and how this could affect their deen and faith?
One word, responsibility. This is a tool that needs to be used responsibly, just like a motor vehicle. You drive responsibly. If you don't, you will cause harm. You may die. You can lose your life. So much can happen. But if you use it responsibly, the same applies to a knife or anything else. You know, you use it to cut your food, to cook, to do whatever, perhaps as a tool of benefit, not as a tool of harm, not as a tool of injury and murder, etc. So the same would apply to social media. It's a tool. How you use it will actually determine what you get from it. it would either be beneficial or harmful. And this is why we continue to say, watch those who are using it beneficially, in a beneficial way, and try your best to understand that I need to do as much benefit as I can for myself and others. Maximize it with this gift of Allah, known as social media. Because if I don't use it as a gift of Allah, then it will become a means of my destruction. There are so many people who are hooked onto the wrong things. Sometimes the pressure to show off, just to show off, which some people consider okay. But as Muslims, we know we shouldn't be doing that. The pressure to show off is so much that even good people get caught up in it. And as a result, they start competing with each other. They become jealous of each other. They start hating on each other and so many different things. And just today, I put out a tweet earlier today, you know, words to the effect that we need to be careful what we put up. Because a lot of the jealousy and envy out there sometimes is for a situation that doesn't really exist. We have photoshopped what we want people to see.
Yes.
And they're jealous of us based on what we don't even have. We just lied about it, you know. So this is something that is really very important regarding social media. I try my best. I'm a human being. We do make mistakes, perhaps, and I'm always open to correction. And I'd like people to let me know where I'm going wrong, alhamdulillah. But at the same time, I try my best to be as balanced as possible. On that social media, the comments people make say more about them than they do about you. So be careful how you react. I always find that when people swear you, they say the worst of things, you know, they're only exposing themselves, not you. You need to continue saying that which is good. Don't be intimidated. It's only human that we get upset sometimes, frustrated sometimes, but the winner is the one who has the most control over that aspect.
Forgiveness and going back to our Maker. When is the best time for a Muslim to repent, if you will, and to leave Sirat al-Mustaqim?
The essence of forgiveness is felt more by those who know how to forgive others. That's something that's very important for us to note. I will never know the true value of being forgiven by Allah until I can forgive others. Because the crimes we commit against Allah are usually bigger than the crime against us. But we find it so difficult to let go. And this is why Allah says, وَلَمَنْ صَبَرَ وَغَفَرَ إِنَّ ذَلِكَ لَمِنْ عَزْمِ الْأُمُورِ. While you have a right to hold what someone has done against you in a way that you will achieve the justice, whether it's in this world or the next, Allah says what is better for you is to bear patience and to let it go, to forgive. So that's an encouragement from who? From Allah. If He is telling that to us, we need to make sure we understand that He is more forgiving. And it is even greater for us to seek His forgiveness, because what we've done against Him is far worse. The effect of it will go into the hereafter, into an everlasting life. So we need to make sure that we seek that forgiveness, inshallah. Now getting back to when to seek that forgiveness on a daily basis. Never underestimate the words that you say to your Maker as you pass your day. Oh Allah, forgive me. Grant me paradise. Have mercy on me. Oh you who made me. Oh you whom I'm going to return to. Have mercy on me. We will achieve the mercy of Allah. These words are written by the angels. They don't just pass without being written. But we sometimes forget to seek the forgiveness of Allah. Weeks pass, months pass. When the Prophet, peace be upon him, used to seek the forgiveness of Allah up to 100 times a day, according to a narration. Yet when it comes to us, days pass, weeks pass. We haven't even said, oh Allah, forgive me. But we commit sin. He did not actually commit sin, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was perfect. So it's important for us to know, daily basis, we seek the forgiveness of Allah. Let it be serious. Let's try our best to change our lives. Let's work on our bad habits. You know, just like we want to develop a relationship with anyone who's important on earth, the most important in the entire existence is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Creator. So what's important there is for us to know that relationship needs to be built every day. We need to consider it. Many of us are busy earning a livelihood. Tough countries where you come from, I come from. These countries are not first world countries. In fact, even in first world countries, people suffer and struggle. But what we definitely need to know is, as we struggle and as we want to earn a livelihood to have the plate of food in front of us, we must make sure we have built the hereafter. That will be by developing ourselves, improving our character and conduct, seeking forgiveness, developing our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this needs to be repeated again and again.
Talking about earning a living, it's interesting. A few years ago, we are perhaps the first radio station that had started doing your Ramadan series in Gambia, Paradise FM. And I asked this question. I said, is this copyright material? Can we actually use it? And then a day or two later, I think Al-Amin emailed you. He said, no. All of this is free. You could use it. It's to spread the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not really for income generation. How do you make a living? If you go out there, most likely volunteering time, energy, effort, knowledge into building others, how do you build you?
You know, that's a very interesting question. Very interesting. I thank Allah that He has given me the ability, you know, to earn that which is just sufficient for myself and my family. Whatever I've done for this, for Islam, from the beginning, has always been totally free of charge, without any copyright. If it is done for Islam, for the deen, for the sake of Allah, it has been open for everyone to make use of by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, we have a little family business back at home from which, alhamdulillah, I benefit as well. So as much as others are doing the bulk of that work, I am doing the bulk of this work. So alhamdulillah, even for the religious work that I do, I've never taken a salary. I don't charge, as much as a lot of people must be thinking, and I know they do, that, you know, it must be costing millions of dollars to bring this man. I know of a lot of others who do the same work. I don't blame them because that is their means of living. In my case, I thank Allah. That's not my point of income. And alhamdulillah, like I say, we have a little family business that keeps us going by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You may be surprised if you were to come to my part of the world to see how I live and my standard of living and the way I actually lead myself or my family. You may be surprised. You know, people sometimes think, oh, this guy must be a multimillionaire, etc., etc. I thank Allah that I don't have greed within me for that which is material. If you notice, I don't wear a watch. I probably won't ever have a pen, generally, unless I need to use it. It won't be. I've given up so many things. I will always wear more or less the same type of clothing, similar shoes all along. Just today, I was given a pair of shoes, local shoes, and I decided to put them on just to be in sync with the rest of the local people. But otherwise, generally, alhamdulillah, I don't mean to say any good about myself, but since you asked me the question, you know, what do you need on earth? What is going to make you happy? You have a car. If it's a Toyota Corolla like mine, or it's a Mercedes like someone else's, it will still get you from point A to point B. I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, you know, He has blessed us in a million ways. Whether I'm going to eat my food that is perhaps worth $5 and someone else might eat food worth $50, they're still going to fill the same cavity and the same belly. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, indeed. At times we do know that, you know, everyone has their needs. Everyone would like to go on holiday. Everyone would like to actually, you know, spoil themselves a little bit here and there. It depends how much you want to do and what your life is focused upon. So my focus, alhamdulillah, is on serving the ummah, serving the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, part of that is to help your family and to ensure that, you know, they're not struggling, suffering. That's the duty of every one of us. But alhamdulillah, everything has been. It was actually the advice of the late Ahmed Didat, rahmatullahi alayhi. I met him 2 years before he passed away. And he told me, while he couldn't speak, actually he spoke with his eyes. Mm-hmm. He couldn't speak like us because he was paralyzed from head to toe. Mm-hmm. And he told me that, you know what, don't copyright whatever you do if you'd like it to reach the four corners of the globe. And I didn't copyright it from the very beginning. And you know what, alhamdulillah, I believe that it has reached more than I know myself. And I don't need to know. It's Allah who knows. Mm-hmm. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may He accept it and grant us the reward. I'm always overwhelmed visiting countries like yours, the Gambia. Mm-hmm. As we move through the streets, you know, the people are calling me out by name. Mm-hmm. And I say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh Allah, keep us humble, keep us people who understand that it's not us, it's actually You. If we didn't say what You said, we would have not even been known. Mm-hmm. The only reason why we are known is because you are known. Mm-hmm. So it's your words that we are just repeating. Mm-hmm. So who are we? We are nothing. It's actually you who is the power.
You're relatively a young man. In this very interesting world, how do you make sure temptation and other evils never reach you?
I think the guide that I have in my father is actually very, very strong, very disciplined, and extremely focused. And I want to call on the young, you know, those who look at us and they start thinking, wow, I'd like to be like this, you know. Mashallah, we want you to go beyond this, but you must be focused and dedicated. Don't lose focus. If the minute you lose focus, you know, you're gone. Yes, we are human beings. Sometimes we falter. But those faults shouldn't be massive ones where you destroy everything, you know. May Allah protect us all. You know, we are in the spotlight all the time. And it's not so easy, my beloved brother. But we have to keep going and keep asking Allah's protection.
Thank you very much. By way of last question, any general advice to anybody wishing to become Muslim or any Muslim that is found himself, herself outside the deen and wants to come back to find space? And to all general young people that may be listening or watching.
MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. That's a very broad question, but let me try and tackle it in my way. Number one, if anyone would like to enter the fold of Islam, it's very easy. We worship our maker alone. Who made us? We worship him alone. No act of worship is rendered for anyone or anything besides our maker alone. And we follow all the messengers of the Prophet, peace be upon him, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with total respect, ending with the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And therefore, you just have to declare within your heart and on your tongue that there is none worthy of worship besides Allah, and that Muhammad, peace be upon him, is his final messenger. So once you declare that, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadur Rasulullah, or Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, you are a Muslim because you declare it with your heart and your tongue. So that is a simple declaration. People go to others to bear witness. It's not necessary, but it would help you through your life for everyone around you to know that you're a Muslim. This is the beauty of Islam. Your relationship is direct with your maker. Direct. You don't confess to anyone besides your maker. He should know, he knows anyway what you've done. You are remorseful, you seek forgiveness, you promise not to do it again. Your sin is wiped out. There is no sin under the sun that will not be forgiven by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we must remember this, and we must turn to Allah seeking his forgiveness on a daily basis. On a broader scale, I'd like to invite myself, yourself, and all our viewers and listeners to improve ourselves on a daily basis, to keep on looking within our own selves how we can become better people to those around us. Because what happens, my brother, while we are busy in this world, we tend to forget to develop ourselves. Mm-hmm. And in that, we begin to think that religion is only the five prayers, it's only the charity, it's only the fasting, it's only the hajj, and forget about the character and conduct. How we treat people means nothing. May Allah bless you and Allah grant you goodness. You know what? I promise you, we are trying to serve the deen. We are trying to serve the ummah. We are really trying hard. Yes, you know, the world is changing very fast, and so many other things changing, and they are trying to push us to streamline. Wallahi, we are holding as best as we can.
Yes, yes.
With respect. May Allah give us that.
Inshallah. Thank you.